Blessings of truth to all the viewers and listeners here. We have a very specific focus here, even though it may seem we, during cool down periods, we might chat about the weather or about world events or whatever. But really, we have a very specific purpose. And that is for spirit to wake up and realize that it has been pretending all of this. It's all a pretense. 100% pretense, not 99.9%. Okay, the difference between what Jesus teaches, which is the truth of eternal life, and what the ego teaches is that Jesus says it's 100% pretense. And the ego says, well, it's 99.999%, but some little bit is not pretense, you know, that we've been able to somehow change reality. In a little way, the ego says. And Jesus says, no, we didn't change it in even the littlest of way. And he says, even if we believe that we've changed in the littlest of way, we actually are totally denying all of truth, because truth is one. It's one seamless whole. And it's not a bunch of parts put together at all. So you cannot, the idea of changing in the littlest way is exactly the same idea as changing it in totally changing it. It's exactly the same. So this is the difference. And so we're pointing out this adamant black and white teaching here. It's our belief that we're mortal is 100% pretense on our part. Okay, no exception to that. And what we're doing is we are waking spirit up to this fact. And this is a very, very, very specific that we are doing this. And we're aware there's four stages to religious practice, spiritual practice, really. The first phase is longing for eternal life. The second phase is praying for it. The third phase is asserting it. The fourth phase is canceling out all concepts, both positive and negative, so you can abide in it. And we're working here on the fourth phase. And we are far along right now, actually. I had a dream last night, and it was also somewhat of a sort of a half-sleep state. When I woke up, I was working on it, and I saw backstage, behind the scenery, as it were, spirit and mind met one another. I said, uh-oh, oh wow, this is big. This is big time. Behind the scenes, in other words, spirit and mind, behind the scenes, behind this magic show, this show of mirage, illusion, pretense, impersonation, imitation, spirit and mind were both together like that. And I said, okay, what's going to happen? This is extremely significant. So I've been working on this today. And this is very, very crucial, important. This video channel here is the most intense place in the world, actually. All the stuff, the political stuff, the stock market, okay, there's some intensity there. But this is the highest intensity, really, right here. Because this situation is all important, and we don't want to fumble it, right? I know. I said, this is all important. So I'm living with awareness of how important this situation is, and still having to go about a day-to-day humdrum life at the same time. So there's a lot of responsibility, a lot of pressure, for sure. So what do you think I came up with? What do you think happened? Spirit simply said, okay, we're not going, nothing, we're just going to sit down. Let's sit down together. Just sit. Just sit. That's it. Nothing's going to happen. No confrontation, no anger, no confrontation, no discussion, nothing. So nothing happened. Just, okay, let's just both sit down. And so both mind and spirit sat down together. Then spirit said, okay, mind, I want you to start doing this practicing. I am both this and not this practice, okay, as we have been bringing forth here. And so mind began doing this, and spirit kept suggesting this and this and this. And as I went on and practice, I became aware that the body, the speaker, was just an automaton. It was just a puppet. And it was really spirit putting the words in the mouth and then telling the mouth to mouth these words. I became aware of that. And this awareness kind of fluctuated back and forth and back and forth. And as you can imagine, it was a huge wow situation. This is extraordinarily important, and I know it's difficult for the viewer and the listener. I think this kind of response would be like, oh, I don't want to fumble it away. Well, the recognition ebbs and flows as we're working on it here. So what's important is Spirit had the wisdom now to say, we're not going to do anything. We're not going to discuss anything. We're not going to figure anything, come to a deal, figure anything out. Spirit's not going to accuse mind, hey, mind, you're fake. You know, you're just me. You're just pretending to be me. And none of this. We'll just sit down both together and then start doing this practice. Let this practice take place. That was it. Stroke of spiritual genius. And this is where we're at now. And I was able to do this practice very, very significantly, quite extraordinary, to the extent that it was really some of the things that the practice hit home so strong. The wow was just intense. And so the day, I've just been going through the day, functioning just fine. But it is tough to go through a day doing this sort of practicing is... You know, it's something we need to really concentrate and focus on. It's easy to get led away from it. All of the hubbub and turmoil in the world right now, which the Holy Spirit accurately foretold and pointed out to me, is going to start this week, and indeed it has. And it will continue to ratchet up more and more severely around the globe. It's just nonstop, folks. It's just nonstop. So it's better really not to pay too much attention to it, or none at all, really. We have even better intensity here. Because the truth of the matter is that it's spirit that's been pretending to be a mind. Okay, there is no little mind, so to speak. Mortal mind doesn't exist. Mortal mind does not exist at all. Never has. And so its spirit has to come to the recognition of this, and spirit is quite concerned about a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that we have. We're not crazy, we're not evil, we're not terrible. We're eternal life, but we have a continuity problem. And we're so used to pretending that we're dead, that we're not eternal life, that we're mortal existence. We're so used to pretending that we're afraid if we stop pretending that we won't function at all. See, we think pretending is our function. This has to be emphasized over and over and over again. It seems to the people of the world are obstinate and stubborn and wrong-minded, and they are in some way. They're doing nothing but try to oppress and wipe out the truth on this planet, which is true, and then retain their lazy lives. But they do this because of the continuity fear. The continuity fear is crippling them, absolutely crippling them. So the more we can emphasize that the continuity, we have this severe problem called a continuity fear problem, and it's crippling everybody and causing us to lead lazy, spiritually lazy, lazy, useless lives, actually, just wasting our time. It cripples us so badly. The more we can become aware of this, the more of us can start working on it and start evaporating this continuity fear, and it takes a long time to evaporate it. It's a lot of work, but it's better than being lazy, because being lazy gets you nowhere. You just stay ignorant, and the continuity fear just gets more severe, and you just feel absolutely stuck. And you will behave in very bizarre ways, actually, as people don't realize how bizarrely they're behaving right now, mentally, spiritually. Their focus is they're just so into distortion and fear and confusion. I mean, it's just awful. They don't realize it. They feel that they're being safe. They're protecting themselves from losing their functioning. They think their functioning is mind pretending to be, you know, the life, mortal mind. There is no mortal mind. It doesn't exist. when spirit pretends to not be spirit, it has to have a cause of this pretense other than itself, right? If it says, I'm pretending not to be what I am, well, what is that? It's easy to just set it down there. No, it's ridiculous. So spirit has said, no, there's the mind is the one that there's mind, and his mind is causing mortal mind, not me. It's not my pretense. It's actually some other creation of mind and mortal existence. This is, spirit is just making this up. So when spirit meets so-called mind, behind the scenes, behind all the defenses, okay, this is a big moment, because spirit is ultimately going to realize, hey, this mind has never been some autonomous causative agent. It's always been just my own pretense. And once I realize that, I can then stop pretending. It's in my hands. It's not out of my hands. See, I have complete control over it. There's nothing I need to do except to stop doing it, to set it down, gently set it down. So this is extraordinarily big time moment, you know, and spirit handled it just right because we've been practicing and being informed by the Holy Spirit. So my spirit is no longer ignorant, and it did the right thing, which is fantastic progress. I said I've been making historically great progress in truly bringing this practice of imitating abstraction. You know, I am both absolutely clear and absolutely not clear. I both absolutely understand this and absolutely do not understand this. This is imitating abstraction. This practice is the key. It's the Holy Grail, plain and simple. It's the key to the kingdom. It is the Holy Grail. It is what actually works, and I'm experiencing this. So, to put this out there in the world and make it available is a historic moment for the world. I'm very aware of this. This is, you know, vital information of wisdom, and the wisdom is within me now, and in the dream I was able to say, okay, we're not going to have any confrontation or any subject matter or any discussion or whatever. We're just going to sit down. Let's first just sit down quietly and sit still, that's all. I'm not going to attack the mind saying you're unreal or anything. I said, all you're going to do, mind, is do this practice. And so we did that for quite some time, and got deeper and deeper and deeper and more profound with the practice. And it was just tremendous. And this enables spirit to recognize, hey, this is exactly the practice I would recommend to myself if I had pretended that I was not spirit but something else. This is what I would recommend to myself to wake up from this pretense. And then spirit realizes, hey, this practice is happening. And then spirit says, hey, if I connect the dots, this is the practice that I would recommend to myself if the situation was that spirit had gone into a pretending state that it wasn't really spirit but was mine. And this is what I'm hearing right now. It's the exact same practice I would recommend to myself. And then the spirit says, hey, wait a minute. Maybe then I did go into pretending, pretense. See, the light goes on. Spirit says, hey, I connected the dots. It's a direct line, isn't it, between the two dots? So, the Holy Spirit said that Monday the 24th, before it even happened, Holy Spirit told me, there's the volatility that I've been telling you about, it is going to start boiling over. You're going to become aware, even more acutely aware of it. And I said, why? He said, look at the stock market. So I pulled up this website that showed all the stock markets in the world, basically the major ones, the Shanghai, the Hong Kong, and the Japanese, the German, French, and British, American, Mexican, and Brazilian stock markets. And there's a CNN Money Watch something. And I watched as the Chinese market opened, and I saw it go down, and saw all the markets just plummeting, and said, wow, This Holy Spirit was right. And of course, the United States market plummeted 1,000 points, the most in history. And they had 1,200 circuit breakers to prevent flash crash being was triggered. You know, unprecedented situation. And today, Tuesday, also, all the markets, pretty much all of them, are down. U.S. was up for a while and then ended up sharply down again. So there's extreme volatility. So the Holy Spirit is right on the money. It knows what's going on in the world. You have faith in that. The Holy Spirit knows exactly what's going on. It knows everything. And it says that there is volatility, agitation. The fear and greed index is like on 3, almost zero fear. You know, just almost total fear right now in the world. So the Holy Spirit has been saying, look, this is the time. This is the crucial time. And fortunately, we have prepared properly. So I was able to bring this teaching to the world before this next phase of volatility hit. And politically, the volatility is going to get more severe as well. There's no question about it. This is what it's intended to do. It's intentional distraction. The ego will do any distraction whatsoever. The ego doesn't care. See, the ego is impartial to any distraction, whatever. Whatever distracts us away from truth, the ego's fine with. So it will use anything, anything. It has no conscience. It has no shame. It will absolutely use any ploy whatsoever to distract us away from truth. So the Philosopher's Stone, the Holy Grail, the key to the kingdom, is actually this practice of mind imitating abstraction. Mind imitating abstraction. Because then the Spirit will say, hey, that's exactly what I would recommend to myself if I was really in a pickle, you know, and I've forgotten what I am. That's why is the mind doing that? It's very interesting. The mind is doing this. It kind of reminds me of exactly what I would suggest. As if that, you know, why is it doing this? And so Spirit starts waking up, asking the questions of itself. It says, hey, why is mine doing this practice like this? And Spirit likes this practice. It says, hey, this is the kind of practice I would suggest and recommend, exactly this. How is it that mind's doing this? Mind's never done this before. Why is mind doing this now? Is it, you know, I mean, and Spirit starts thinking like, well, maybe, you know, maybe, where did mind get this? And I don't think mind can practice that way. And then Spirit will start thinking, maybe I'm just putting words in mind's mouth. Maybe mind is just a sock puppet. Maybe mind is really not a mind at all. Maybe it's just me doing this. Maybe it's just me doing all of this. So, when this recognition hits, and it will, there's a tremendous wow factor involved with this. And I want to speak about this wow factor because this is really pragmatically dealing with your success is what ultimately enables the success that we're aiming for. And so we have to manage our success, which is full stop on the wow. How do we do this? How do we do this? The practice is simple enough. It's not a difficult practice, but it's so effective that you're going to have a very strong wow from this. And if you're not able to manage the wow, you will stop the practice. There's no question about it. And by the way, it's not a secret practice. I'm sharing with everybody here in the world. Everybody has access that they want to. And it seems secret because nobody uses it. And so just by default, the reasoning says, well, gee, if no one's using it, it must be really, really hidden and secret and hard to find. It's not hidden or secret or hard to find. It's right out in the open here. It's just nobody's, hardly anyone is doing it. Why? Because the wow is so strong. And without the ability to manage the wow, anyone is going to back away from it. They're going to say, oh, wow, it's just too much. It's too much. So, at length, I've been speaking about this wow. I call it this website, this YouTube channel, Walking Together in the Wow. And it really is, because we have tools now to get the job done. It's only a matter of managing the wow factor. That's it. We have the tools. It's like building a beautiful house, and you have all the tools, you're building it, but every time you make a lot of progress, you stand back and look at it and just say, wow, this is looking fantastic. Oh my gosh, what a place this is going to be. And you start thinking about what a place this is going to be, and it, you know, it kind of awes you. So this is the problem, and then you stop working, so you lose your motivation to work. So this is what is crucial, and we have to keep focusing on this wow. And I have some very great information for you about this wow, and that is what I've said before is you need the glass half full instead of glass half empty. This is what the difference is. And so what we do, I've said that the wow is a mixture of trepidation, a mixture of elation and trepidation. So you have the positive and the negative. And so when you feel the wow, you can decide to emphasize one or the other. And what we do here is we emphasize the elation. And we say, this is great. This, look at the progress I'm making. I'm elated. And you make a willful effort to focus on and stress the elation part of the wow, and say, I'm just, this is great, I'm just so elated, but I need to get used to this elation that I have. Then you don't struggle, you're able to just full stop in the wow. Whereas if you go into glasses half empty, you'll start complaining, you have this gloomy disappointment, thinking, oh my gosh, my glass is half empty, I'm struggling with this, I'm having trouble with this, I really can't handle the elation, I'm very fearful and jittery about this, and you start struggling. Whereas if you just say, oh, wow, it's so much elation, I just have to stop for a little bit here and just enjoy it and let it sink in and have a positive outlook. This is called glass half full. This is really the secret, is the glass half full attitude, which is a choice on our parts. So it's amazing how we can flip the script when we may be feeling down and depressed and thinking, oh, this is, you know, life, I can't succeed, I'm being beat, I'm being defeated. If we recognize we're in a severe wow condition and then decide, I'm going to emphasize and stress the elation of this and make a willful effort to do so, you will find that you flip the whole script and your depression and frustration and despair will vanish, will evaporate and gone. And instead, you'll be feeling elation and saying, this is great. I'm absolutely in clover. This is wonderful. I'm a world beater, you know. This is great. Emphasize that elation. Because by doing this practice, we really are world beaters. There's no doubt about that. This is, you know, fourth phase practice, which is the highest practice. And so we're world beaters. So emphasize the elation, like this, I'm going to wake up to eternal life. I'm going to realize I am eternal life. All is eternal life. The flesh was just a dream. Mortal existence has never really existed at all. It's been just a mirage. And I'm right there, right on the cusp of that. So instead of emphasizing the fear of the wow, emphasize the elation. It's the elation trepidation mixture, which is the wow. Because the trepidation comes from a continuity fear. You're saying, I don't know how am I going to be able to function. I'm so used to pretending. And once I realize that this is all just a pretense, I don't really want it, I'll drop the pretending. What do I do then? You know, what's my functioning? But we don't struggle with that question. We say, first let me get used to the elation of this. Because, you know, if I don't get used to the elation of this, nothing's going to happen anyway. So let me give myself a chance. Let me give myself a chance. Let me get used to this. And you just allow it naturally, just to just get used to the feeling. It's like, it's like getting used to the weather. Right now, today, there's a heat spell coming on, and you just say, okay, I just, you know, just get used to it. I got a mustard stain on my shirt, like a T-lock. You know, they put that, the Indians put a T-lock on the third eye area. I got like a T-lock right in my center of my, between the heart, you know, right in the sternum, the center area. And maybe that's a sign of something, right? A T-lock of mustard, yellow mustard. Yeah. It's heating up. Wow. Wonderful. So, it is indeed intense. We have the Holy Grail, and we're drinking from it. We're literally drinking from the true Holy Grail. Keep in mind that what Jesus told us is that his words were full of spirit and life, and the flesh profiteth nothing. Check out John 6:63 through 68, something like that. This is the crucial teaching. This is when many of Jesus' disciples left him, because they thought he was talking literally about eating his flesh and blood, literally. Okay, and of course they were down with that, because that's the you know, ancient pagan custom from time immemorial, which is you take on the attributes of what you eat, and so when they want to, you know, they feel they want to purify themselves, they kill a like an animal without blemish and then eat of that animal's flesh and blood, and they and burn some to God, and they think that then this just purifies from them from their sin, because the flesh that was the flesh, the sheep, whatever, is now in them, you see. And so they thought Jesus was talking about a literal sacrifice, literally eating his flesh and blood. But in John 6:63, Jesus says, no, the flesh profiteth nothing. It's my words, meaning what his advice that he gave us, that are full of the spirit and of life. Okay, that is what, and he says, I want you to eat of this and dine on this. And the term that he used, feast on, he said feast, I want you to feast on this, was really a term which meant chew on it like a cow chews its cud, that the word, the Greek word, that was, it's like chew on it, the way, going back to the Aramaic, I guess, that Jesus would use, is like feast, continually chew on it, chew, it's more like a chewing on it, consider that. So what we're supposed to be doing is considering Jesus' advice, okay, the advice that he gave. And of course he told us that, well, they said, well, wait a minute, you're leaving us. I mean, how are we going to do this? And Jesus said, don't worry, I'm sending you the comfort of the Holy Spirit, and it will in my place, and it will tell you everything you need to know in order to do what I commanded you to do, which is, you know, feast on my words. Those are, that's the bread of life. My advice is the bread of life, okay? And this is when many, many left him and never returned. Okay, and you might say there are many, many, many in the world now professing to be Christians who are like those ones who left Jesus and never returned, because they're still believing in the literal pagan custom of eating literal blood, you know, flesh and blood, instead of practicing the advice that he gave us. And so I can say that getting to where I've gotten to right now, which is quite significant, drinking from the whole true Holy Grail of right spiritual practice, of imitating abstraction, is the result of practice, listening to Jesus' advice. It has nothing to do with eating the literal blood and flesh and blood of Jesus at all. Absolutely nothing to do with it. I've gotten what elephant status, you might call it, elephant status. I'm now what you might consider to be an elephant, which elephants do the heaviest work. I ask myself this question: if I could choose one animal for a friend, you know, of all animals in the world, what animal would I choose to be a friend? I never thought about this question before, and most people would just knee-jerkly say, well, of course, a dog or a cat, you know. Some will have some more different responses, but I thought about it. I said, you know what? Well, I said, well, obviously, if I could, you know, I never thought it's possible. But of course I would choose an elephant. I mean, it's a no-brainer. It's just that we think that's not an option. But it is. It is an option. Imagine if you could have an elephant as a friend. Oh, my gosh. I would choose an elephant over a dog or a cat any day. Holy cow. Just imagine having a really big, powerful elephant as your dear friend. See, elephants can move an entire forest. They do the super heavy work. They do work that's so heavy that no other animal can do it. They can lift and carry trees. I mean, elephants can drag, you know, all sorts of trees. They can do anything, right? I mean, they're so super powerful. And imagine being able to ride up on an elephant's back, elevated above the world. You know, how awesome would that be? And the elephants will look out after you. They're so smart, and they have such great memory, and they're super loyal. you know, and they're very aware animals. And holy cow, I said, I would pick an elephant. And I was super, super surprised by this. It never crossed my mind, you know, that I would pick an elephant. But if you think about it, it's like a no-brainer. Who's going to mess with an elephant? I'd do it today. I'd get up on the back of an elephant right now. I think we need it. We need to, don't we? In the way the world's going right now, I think we all need an elephant as our totem animal, actually. Absolutely we do. It reminds me of that dream I had of these gigantic elephants. I was stuck on this cliffs, on this jagged, I was trying to climb this mountain, and it was incredibly jagged, and I was stuck up there. I couldn't get down. It was too dangerous. And this pack of elephants came by, and the elephants were massive, gigantic. They were bigger than the whole world. They were bigger than this world, these elephants. That's how big they were. And they asked me, do you need some help to get down from there? I said, yes. And they said, okay, well, no problem. And they lifted me, used their trunk, and they just lifted me right off of there, like an elevator like this, and then just put me down. And then they said, would you like to come with us? We're going somewhere else. And I said, yeah, sure. And then I saw across space some other place. I saw the light of some stars in some other place, and they were going there. But for them, it was just like a nice little trek, you know. And I said, oh, yeah. I said, this place here is getting too jagged. You know, we're stuck. We're stuck. It's too jagged. People's ideologies are jagged right now, aren't they? This is what I'm getting. I just checked in with the news, and I said, oh my gosh, I can't keep looking at this. I get too upset. See, I get very upset by the media. I've been a media watchdog my whole life, and I'm very, very skilled in this. And I catch exactly what they're doing, and it's vicious what they're doing. Just totally irresponsible. It's jagged to the max. And, you know, this sets the tone. Who sets the tone for the country? The media does. And the tone that they're setting for this country is simply atrocious, and for the world in general. It's too jagged, so we want out of here. We don't want off this jaggedness in some way. So the elephants came and helped me out. And I take it the elephants to mean these great spiritual beings that have completely awoken to the fact that nothing has ever happened to them. They never departed from eternal life. They know that all is eternal life endlessly. And these are the great, great elephants. You know, they can put you up. They were so big I was afraid to ride on their backs, actually, at this point. Maybe I would do it now. That would be a nice ride, wouldn't it? The elephants can walk through the swamps, they walk through the brush, I mean, and you're on their back and you're not touched by it, you see? They can take you where you want to go, so. So I realized that, what is the elephant again? The elephant does the heaviest of the heaviest work. They're the ones capable of doing the heaviest work. And then I realized that I've done the heaviest work, spiritual work, getting to this holy grail of telling the mind to practice imitating abstraction. This is the getting to this is the heaviest practice of all. And so being able to do this, you know, it means I'm an elephant, spiritual elephant. I've done the heavy work in my life, and this is true. I look back and I can say for sure I did the heavy lifting, worked like an elephant. Clearing a whole forest. There's a whole forest that need to be clear of confusion. Cleared the whole forest out. And, you know, dog can't do that. Dog can't do that. Elephant is the only creature that can really do that. And not be worked to death. So, elephants tend to congregate with one another, right? They do. They like to go in herds and packs of elephants. An elephant see another elephant. Ah, hello, elephant. How are you? You know, they congregate together. So, it's you know, it seems to me some elephants will congregate with me in some way. Absolutely. Some, you know, spiritual elephants. It's not a surprise that I, you know, seem to be having contacts with these great spiritual beings who have, you know, awoken from self-delusion. They're, you know, great, great elephants, and they're saying, hey, there's another elephant. I want to go say hi to this elephant. And we speak the same language. We speak the same language. I was listened to Ram Maharshi video, and I realized, oh my gosh, we're speaking the same language. I can understand what he's saying and getting at. It's not a trouble in my mind. It's like one elephant recognizes another. And I was pretty stunned by this. And he's just giving great advice. All Ram Maharshi is doing is giving fantastically great advice. It's just that, you know, you have to have the ears to hear it. And I heard it, and I said, oh, I know exactly what the advice is given out. That's right on the money. Spot on. And so it's dawning on me, I'm an elephant now. I'm a real elephant here. So it's not surprising if some other elephants, you know, come by and say hello, and I start congregating with some elephants, you know. It's not a surprise. So who knows what the fruit of these labors? I know the fruit is going to come, because this practice is the Holy Grail. There's no question about it. And I'm doing it, and doing it very well. So the fruits of this path are going to arrive at some point. Now, I don't know what those fruits are going to be like. I really do not know. But, you know, hey, they will arrive, so I'm sure they'll be great, whatever it is. But I can't tell anybody, you know, this is going to happen like this or that like that, in terms of, I really am in, still, it's still obscure. I don't know how the fruits are going to taste and what they're, you know, going to be like exactly. But they're sure to come. The fruits of labor, this type of labor, are sure to come at some point. Just who knows how it's going to play out. I don't really worry about it too much. I just keep working, keep practicing. But it'd be good if they came soon, really soon, really, really soon. So we're pressing forward here as much as possible. And now I understand that doing this fourth phase practice of the mind imitating abstraction, you know, this is drinking from the Holy Grail. So not everybody is going to feel ready for it. Their continuity fear. Well, what happens is you do it, and then you realize, oh my gosh, this is working. And then you say, just like panicking, go, wow, 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 wow. First the wow, wow hits you. And then so much elation that you start thinking, whoa, I gotta, how do I turn down this elation? And then what you do is then you go into the fear and use that fear to tune down the elation. So what I'm suggesting to everyone is do not do that. That's the wrong move to make. The right move to make is at all costs stay with the elation, except just do not try, let me see. What you say is, I'm not going to do anything about it. I'm just going to sit here still, just sit here still, sit here still, sit here still, and just let the elation die down a little bit on its own accord. Do not try to counterbalance it with fear. Okay, with trepidation. Do not, that's why I say full stop in the wow, neutral. You just stay in neutral mode. Say, I'm just staying in neutral and see what happens. The elation will gradually subside, and you just let it subside. This is the whole quote-unquote secret to success. The entire key secret to success is managing your success properly. And this is the key to managing it, is don't try to counterbalance the elation with focusing on the fear, because then you'll start getting into this fearful mindset, and that you'll be pulled away by it, and you'll end up being confused, losing your momentum, retreating, and having a very difficult time starting your practice again. So you'll waste a lot of time that way. It's what you want to avoid at all costs. So you must emphasize the elation. Do not allow the fear don't try to counterbalance it with the fear. It's there, but don't focus on it. And just tell myself, no, I'm elated. I'm in a state of elation. This is the state I'm really in. And I just have to cool out and just let it subside a little bit. Because when you drink from the Holy Grail of right spiritual practice, which is the true Holy Grail, it's going to hit you for. It's going to dawn upon you for sure. Spirit will say, "Hey, wait a minute. Is this mind practicing, or is this me practicing? Am I just having mind mouth my practice is, as if like a sock puppet, as if it were some separate entity? You know, which one is it?" And then Spirit will say, "Oh my gosh, what if it is me? I'm seeing that's very possible. It is me. And then it's just a wow will just, you know, it'll just arise in you. And then this is when you need to realize, I'm in tremendous elation right now. And I certainly am in tremendous elation every day. And I have to be careful. I mean, it's not easy managing it. You know, don't be hard on yourself in terms of if it's difficult. It's absolutely difficult. Yeah, I swing. Sometimes I do go to the fear and say, you know, I just got this elation. I don't know how, you know, is it going to wear off, you know? But it's a question of also getting used to it and accepting it. Used to it and accepting it. And this becomes a new baseline for you. So really, in these practices, we practice establishing a new baseline of elation. Okay, it's really practicing a new baseline of elation. And I got to look out about commenting on the world, because I'm so fearless, you know, about saying commenting now, that, you know, I'm liable just to say stuff that people just say, it's too much. Really, I really could, and you know I can, and sometimes do. Yeah, I try to just stay away from that, not emphasize it so much, you know. It's true, but it's also true that it's not nearly as important as drinking from the Holy Grail of right spiritual practice. That's what's truly important, and emphasizing managing your success. You know, this is what has not been emphasized properly throughout history and has caused the great slowdown that we've experienced over, you know, thousands of years. We're wondering, how come we haven't had more success? Because we haven't learned how to manage our success properly. You have to believe in your success. You have to have faith in your success. And then that helps you realize, hey, this is elation. I'm succeeding. You know, I really am succeeding. This is where the great teachers help us, because they say, look, I succeeded, and you're going to also. You're going to also. Ramana Maharshi, back in about the year 2000, in a dream, came to me and said, you're going to succeed. He says, I know you are, because I can see it. I can see time, you know, I can see through time. And he says, I know for a fact that you're going to be extremely successful and a great help. And he says, so don't quit. He says, absolutely do not quit. Just keep doing what you're doing and stick it out. So that gave me a huge boost, huge boost. Because then I said, you know what? If he says so, okay, I'm gonna take that to the bank. So I'm gonna keep at it. And so when we believe that we're going to succeed, then it's a lot easier to focus on the full stop on the wow, and focus on the elation and say, yeah, this is because I am succeeding. There's no question about it. So you have this positive faith and belief in yourself. And this is really, really important. And I'm getting a call. I may have to vacate here for 1 second. Yeah, hold on 1 minute. So believe in yourself, you know, and know, you know, hey, you know, I'm going to do it. I'm going to realize that I'm eternal life. There's no way in the world that I can ever believe in mortality. I never believed in mortality, actually, here. I never believed in it. And people said, you're just crazy. What are you talking about? This is just pipe dream. You know, you're just off your rocker. I said, no, I don't believe in mortality. I will never believe in mortality. Mortality is not true. Plain and simple. And I still feel this way. Everything that mortality has tried to do to me, no, I don't believe in it at all. Eternal life is the only life there is. Mortal life is a pretense. So if you have this attitude, then you know you're going to wake up. You know you're going to wake up. So you know you're going to have success. So you know you have to learn how to manage your success. It's of paramount importance. And there's just like almost no teaching at all about this. It's just amazing. It's just amazing because most teachers don't really believe. I don't know what they're really getting at ultimately, but the world by and large doesn't believe that mortal life is just an illusion, a mirage, a pretense. It believes that, you know, the classical teaching of is usually that we are mortal. we're mortal lives, but we can associate somehow, there's some connection, we have some connection with eternal life, and somehow we can transmigrate, you know, transubstantiate somehow from mortal life to eternal life and stuff like that. And of course Jesus says that one of his major keys is to say the big mistake we make is trying to make illusions real and then overcoming them. Ramana Maharshi says exactly the same thing, is that we imagine all these imaginary limitations that we have and then strive to overcome and defeat these limitations. And he says that only reinforces the belief that the limitations are real. Same thing Jesus says, when we try to make illusions real and then try to overcome them. And the trying to overcome illusions makes them seem real to us. And this is what gets in our way. So there's not a lot of conviction in the world that we really are eternal life and we absolutely can realize it. In fact, there's no doubt we will. It has to be very cut and dried like this. There's no question. No question. I have no question in my mind that I'm going to realize eternal life, that I'm already eternal life. It's absolutely I'm going to. And then the whole thing is in the wow of this. Like, wow. This is wow, isn't it? And this is what has to be emphasized in the world, in any world, is you have no choice but to realize that you're eternal life. No one has any choice in this whatsoever. There's no such thing as mortal life. It has never existed and never will exist. And so we have to learn then to manage our success, right? There's no way around it. So cradle the grave, this is what should be taught in the world. And if we did cradle the grave teaching of this, this we would not, very soon we would all wake up and realize, oh my gosh, I am eternal life and this was all just a pretense. Very soon, it wouldn't take long. Instead, everybody works against it. If they use that energy and effort that they use to work against it, they've used it for waking up, we'd all wake up very soon. Isn't that a tragedy? It's an incredible pity and a tragedy that life after life after life, we use all our energy and effort to defend mortal life and refuse truth. If we just use that effort to work on evaporating the continuity fear, we would have woken up a long time ago. Anyway, so this is just the facts of the situation. The only problem we have is the continuity fear problem. That is it. We don't have any other problem. But it's a very nasty, severe problem. And tackling it is, a lifetime endeavor. It's a career. But it's a career that nobody can afford to, avoid. The only thing you can do is, if you avoid it, then you'll just be lazy. That's it. There's really two options we have. We can either take on this challenge and get it done, or simply lead a life of laziness. That is it. There isn't any other option. It's very black and white. And again, Jesus said, come feast at my table. Come feast to this new table I have for you. And in the dream of this terrible storm that's coming upon the world, this table was given to me, a black and white granite, which is, adamant, black and white, no compromise teaching, which is the teachings that Jesus has given out and other teachings, for instance, Ramana Maharshi. And this is the new table. And this gives us protection from the storm. So he says, come to this new, Jesus says, come to the new table I have for you and feast at this table, right? This is what will give you eternal life. Jesus was all about eternal life. People are saying, what do you talk about eternal life? I don't understand that. Yeah, well, he says, you will eventually. You will eventually. But you have to work on this continuity fear. So we either work on this evaporating the continuity fear or we lead a life of laziness. This is what the Holy Spirit told me, was what Jesus told me, and that's what fired me up, because I realized the Holy Spirit was right. If I didn't tackle this challenge, I would have lived a life of laziness. No question about it. No question. I might have been, I was watching the Bee Gees concert live concert from Australia or something. The Bee Gees at their best. They did all their famous songs. They were in top form, and the backing band was just amazing. I mean, this is like pinnacle of pop music, really. That concert, I don't know what year it was recorded in, but that was something. But really, looking at it, the lyrics were just puerile, just puerile, you know, oh, I'm so infatuated with you. I'm, you know, I just can't live without you, and you're just amazing, and you're the light of my life. You know, it's just special relationship, puerile nonsense. It's just terrible lyrics. But the singing is really, and you know, the musicianship was really good. And yet, you know, you look at them, you realize, you know, I said, there, that's what I could have done. You know, I mean, I could walk on the stage with the Bee Gees this very instant and not be bothered at all, and you know, fit right in, be not a problem at all. But I said, no, what a waste, you know, what a waste of life. You know, even though you sound great singing, they're just singing silly love songs, basically, is all you're doing. And really hooking people into that, which is terrible. You know, just all the trips and special relationships, all the, you know, kind of infatuations and heartbreak and mind games. You know, that's all their songs are about, really. And what a waste, you know, what a lazy life to lead, actually. You think that, you know, those stars, you know, that's a great life. No, it isn't. No, it isn't. Been there and done that in previous life, so to speak. And I said, oh, what's the, you know, after you sing, all the chairs tied down, all the lighting and everything, and then what? Then what? Do you know what? Are you drinking from the Holy Grail of right spiritual practice? Not at all. You don't even have the foggiest notion of what it is. So really, there's this fog. You live in a fog. The lazy live in a fog. Their whole life is lived in a fog. I hate the fog, you know, in that regard. Like all these fog machines churning out stuff on stage, too. You know, I recognize, you know, I was never really that much into the Bee Gees because they became real famous by the disco era, you know, the Saturday Night Fever or something. I wasn't into that. They had some songs before that were really, really good. But really, I mean, looking back, I think they may be the most successful pop band in history. The songs and that they composed and the way they produce the songs are, like, you know, second to none, really. Second to none. So, you know, they're a good touchstone. Watching that's a good touchstone to say, hey, you know, what about music? Are you kidding me? What a joke. What a joke it is. It's just a sophisticated excuse for being lazy is all it is. And the people going home, are they edified? Are they truly edified? No. Ah, yeah, they're screaming and yelling, and they go, wow, that was fun, that was fun. They go home, and they go to sleep in a fog. I mean, are they any more enlightened than when they, before they went to the concert? Absolutely not. Just a bunch of ear candy. Yeah, I mean, so you're not going to get, you know, much better than the Bee Gees. I mean, that music, I mean, that time, I think it was like maybe it was 79, they did the chord. I mean, that... You know, that was like the peak. It's like one of the peaks of music right then. How they got those sounds, that band, I don't know. You know, that's when keyboards that started producing a bunch of interesting sounds. But the disco sound that they got and everything they got is just, I mean, they're just extraordinary palette. And then their vocals are always, you know, just locked in, you know, being brothers. So Robin, Barry, and Maurice, and then Andy, as well, wasn't there, just three of them, but yeah, they're the brothers, they're locked in, they just sound great, but it's totally superfluous, you know, absolutely, no depth to it, really, just singing about how we should all be obsessed with a special relationship, you know, which is such utter nonsense. That's the road to perdition. Everybody's freaked out in the world. Everybody's jagged. I was talking to some young people today, some young men. My God, they were opening up to me and just what's on their mind. I mean, they're just sick of it. They're just absolutely grossed out, actually, by the special relationship, you know, and what's going on in the world. They're just grossed out. They say, this is hideous. Wow. You know, they're very jagged. People are very on edge right now. And, you know, this best relationship is just, it isn't working. It is not working. What's going on? And the guys are at the end of their rope, I'm telling you. They were just expressing, you know, this is just, you know, it's just hideous. What's going on? I understand. But it's interesting to hear it, you know, from the horse's mouth. So we're very jagged. The world is in a very jagged condition. Don't think that there's all the solace, you know, in the special relationship. And don't think that people are satisfied with what's going on. They're not. The sex, drugs, and rock and roll thing is worn thin. And now you get the jaggedness of it. You know, you're starting to feel the jaggedness of it. Wow. You feel the totalitarianness of it all. The enslavement of it all. That you're always wrong. You know, you have no legal recourse, really. You know, and you begin to feel all of this. And then you say, whoa, what do I do? And then people, of course, you know, look to drugs, but the drugs are very jagged too. You feel the jaggedness of drugs. Then you maybe think music will do it, but music doesn't do it. And I can tell you that for sure. Music won't do it for you. It's very important to hear. Music will never do it for you. It doesn't even remotely take on the wisdom that you need to drink of the from the Holy Grail, which is to do right spiritual practice. You won't have the spiritual wisdom. It doesn't give it to you. Absolutely doesn't. I was super saturated in music for a long, long, long time, previous lives and this one, and I found out it doesn't work, and I had to get away from it and start getting serious. And now looking back, I can see that there was not one iota of anything in that Bee Gees concert that had any relevance whatsoever to the spiritual path, really, and wisdom. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. And yet it was, you know, the most, you know, best produced, you know, live performance I've ever seen in terms of the quality of it all. You know, hit after hit after hit. I mean, it was just, every song was extraordinary. The way they started them, the way they ended them, the way everything was done, top notch. Absolutely top notch. I mean, they had the best, you know, players in the world, basically. I mean, these guys were just very talented, and the whole thing was done so tastefully and smoothly. My gosh. And yet, not a bit of light does it shed. Entertainment does not shed even the tiniest beam of light upon truth, upon what we need to know. So we do that, we're just remaining incredibly lazy. Now, I did it to kind of tone down my elation, really. I was feeling so elated, you know, I just like, wow, how can I tone this down, you know? And it's not easy. I actually, you know, eat too much these days because I'm kind of trying to, you know, tone down the elation. It's tough being feeling so elated. It really is. But what choice do we have? But you get acclimatized to it. So then you can handle more. It's like developing a tolerance for elation. Now, if you're depressed, look at it this way. You may be trying to, I would suggest to you that you're trying to tone down your elation. You're trying to tone down your elation because you're not aware of a better way to do it. This full stop in the wow is way better than depression. I used to use depression, but it doesn't work. Because then you can't really practice when you're depressed, right? You sort of get stuck in it. Of course, that it's very sticky, so that's what you look for. I'm so elated, it's scaring me. I want to really be secured away, you know, I want to be secured away from this. And so you get into this very stickiness, which we call depression. It's very sticky. It's hard to get out of it. So, take this to heart. Those who are in despair and depression, you're using that to tone your elation down, because your continuity fear is rather frightened about the elation. but instead say, no, I'm going to feel the elation and just go in this full stop into neutral mode. I'm not going to judge for it or against it. I'm going to feel it, but I'm not going to judge for or against it. And I'm just going to determine to get used to it. And when you do that, you'll find the depression is just gone. It's not there anymore. It was just a device you were using, just like Velcro. Depression's like a Velcro, and you're like Velcroing yourself to it. You know, it's very sticky. But you can get free of that, pull yourself free of it by just be determined to, I'm going to feel the elation, and I'm not going to do anything about it, pro or con. I'm just going to get used to it and make a conscious, willful effort. So this bugaboo of depression is one of my specialties, having experienced it to such a hideous extent. I know exactly all about it, and I know the suffering is so hideous, and I'm determined to bring the cure for depression, you know, into the world, and I've brought it into the world. It's here. This is what we're doing now, is the cure for depression, actually. It's just a device we use. And we absolutely can come out of it. We absolutely can come out of it. When we become conscious and aware of what we're really doing, we're really waking up to eternal life. We're scared because we realize that we want to stop pretending. But we glimpse eternal life and we get elated and say, oh my gosh, it's possible. And this elation frightens us. There's a mixture of elation and fear. It's called the wow. And instead of just full stop in the wow, we try to get some sort of stronger medicine for it, which is called depression. We velcro ourselves to this gloomy disappointmentness kind of feeling, and then we feel it's very difficult to get free of it. And the more you practice full stop on the wow, the more convinced you become that you can overcome depression. And that's another big wow, isn't it? For those who have been depressed, it's an enormous wow to recognize, you know what? I'm going to put this in my rearview mirror. Because it seems like a death sentence, doesn't it, depression? It not only does it seem like a death sentence, it's worse than that. A death sentence is nothing. You know, compared to depression, because depression seems like an eternal death sentence. You know, you see people go to their death here, get their heads chopped off, and you know, I say, well, you know, I just have to accept it. But in depression, it feels like you're going to be this way forever, that even death won't free you from it, that it's never going to end. That's how sticky it is. Because you're running away from eternal life, so of course you're going to take the position that you're never going to get eternal life. You're always going to be stuck in mortal life. You know, and that's hideous. The belief you're always going to be stuck at mortal life is real, and this is what you are, and you'll always be this, is incredibly depressing, isn't it? So, of course you're going to feel terrible. But you're just hiding from eternal life. That's all. If I can get out of the depression that I was in, everybody can get out of the depression that they're in. There's no doubt about it. My depression was so severe, all the doctors gave up. There's nothing we can do. Sorry. All the treatments, everything failed. because I was so terrified of eternal life, because I knew I can do it, and the society is so against it. You know, I felt like I don't dare do it. And so I got to make sure I don't do it. So I had to hold on to depression as the way I prevented myself from, you know, witnessing to eternal life here. That's how I prevented myself. So I had to use extremely strong measures to prevent myself. And you might be feeling some elation right now hearing this. And just realize that's the wow, it's elation. That's great. That's what you want. Mortal life has nothing on us. Absolutely nothing on us. Never will. Never has and never will. So you will get out of your depression. There is no doubt about it. Getting out sooner is, of course, preferable, right? You don't want to just languish there. So having the cure for depression is a big responsibility. I mean, that's as bad as it gets. I mean, other illnesses, you say, well, I'm sick, I'm going to die, okay, whatever, it's terrible. But depression is different. You feel like you're going to be, you know, in hell forever. It's a mental outlook. And that is, you know, you're just absolutely despondent. You just don't know how you can go on at all. So I tasted that fruit to the ultimate, and so of course I'm committed to showing the way out of that. You know, I wouldn't wish such a situation on anyone. Nobody would. And again, the trouble was I didn't know how to manage my success properly. You need, spirit has to recognize that its capacity is so extraordinary, its creativity is so unbounded, that when it pretends to be dead, spirit is going to believe, in large measure believe, that that's its functioning, that pretending to be dead is its functioning. It will, you know, spirit will convince itself, all but convince itself, that this is true. And therefore, there's a massive continuity fear in recognizing this is not true. Because then spirit's always saying, well, how will I function? I'll lose my functionality. This is the trap that we have. And so this has to be, you know, brought into the light, as which what we're doing here. Consciously see that this is the dynamic that's going on. It's psychoanalysis is, you know, it's child's play. And me being born into the era of psychoanalysis and such, you know, people said, no, this is the context you got to use for advanced understanding. I said, whoa, no, that's not going to work. And but the culture was so overwhelmingly, you know, geared to that, you know, I couldn't get through to anybody. And so then eternal life, you know, I said, well, how do I reach, you know, how can I be mortal life? Maybe I am. I have to be that way. And then it made eternal life seemed fearful. I got all confused, and you know, and then the elation became, you know, something dangerous to avoid, and the way to avoid it is depression. Some people drink themselves into a stupor. Alcoholism is another way to avoid it. Sex, drugs, rock and roll are a way to avoid elation. Absolutely, genuine spiritual elation that comes from knowing that. You know, you seeing that I am free. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. You know, what does an elephant worry about, you know, ants? You know, it doesn't really worry about the ants, does it? So we feel like, well, how can we ever do this? Well, you become an elephant, and you know, you're not so much bothered by those who, you know, who are fearful of elation and truth. Most people are in situations where nobody around them supports the idea that they're really eternal life, right? And this is a very brutal, very difficult situation. But you just realize they're suffering from, you know, incredibly brutal continuity fear, and they don't have the will yet to, you know, really take it on and challenge it. Say, hey, I can't let this stand. This is not right. But take hope in those that have done this. You know, this is what I've always done my whole life. I said, hey, someone's done it. I can do it. I pointed out to people, hey, you know, Ramana Maharshi, look, he did it. And they say, well, you're not Ramana Maharshi. I say, well, he's telling us that we all can be. We can have the same realization. He says, ah, that's nonsense. You're just dreaming. You're just dreaming. And so, what's going on here? Did it stop? No, it's still going. The computer's just doing all sorts of weird things. So people won't believe you. Of course they won't believe you. They won't believe you. How can anyone believe? That would threaten their own, continuity fear. It would give rise to a severe continuity fear. It would give rise to a severe wow in them. If they recognize, hey, I recognize that you are going to awaken to eternal life. That's going to give them a huge wow, isn't it? Like, wow. And if they don't know how to manage their wow, they're going to retreat away from that and either usually get angry at you. Either, if it's somebody else bugging you, you get angry at them. If it's you that are afraid of your own elation, you go into depression. So when the people say, well, depression is just repressed anger, it's not quite like that, actually. Usually when someone else is causing your too much wow factor, you get angry at them. And you might become passively aggressive, but you don't get depressed. But if it's your own elation that you're terrified of, you're going to intentionally stick yourself down into depression. And you can express all the anger that you want. It may give you a little temporary boost, but you go right back into the depression. It doesn't resolve the underlying issue at all, really. And it's not anger at people. It's the issue is eternal life. This is something that all psychotherapy is entirely missed. Completely missed. They missed the boat. Completely missed the boat. It's all about eternal life for us. There is no other issue. It has nothing to do with integrating anything. You don't integrate mortal life with eternal life. There's no such thing as mortal life. It's a complete pretense. We're making it up. We're imagining it. We're dreaming it. Eternal life is dreaming that it's not eternal life. But that doesn't give any reality to the dream. Denial, denying. We can deny what we are, but it doesn't make it true. So, I'd say no, psychotherapy is bunk. It's, and they say, what do you think? You think you're smarter than, Carl Gustav Jung or whatever his name was. Jung. First they say Freud. I say, Freud, it's fine, but it's not really that deep. Yeah, but Jung's very deep. He's in all the archetypes of the soul, and everything. I think Jung once said that he was terrified to sit with Ramana Maharshi. Terrified. At least he's honest about it, He was terrified of eternal life. He was trying. Kudos to him for trying, right? I got no problem with that. It's just that people try to use that and say, oh, what a egomaniac you are to think that you know more than, Carl Jung. Oh my gosh, that was the real, Roberto Acigioli, integral yoga, integral this, integral that, these people who are, to suggest that you somehow knew better than them was like blasphemy. And this is the problem I had, growing up, is I said, no, I had a dream last night, actually, where someone gave me this book, and they thought it was some book, a spiritual book, and it's all these pull-out stuff and fold-out things that popped open and all these gewgaws and gimmicks and stuff that kept falling off the book, and they said something that I just said, no, you're not right. That's a mistake. And they got so upset with me. You know, and then I said, and then I had to put the book back in its case right properly and everything. It was just a real pain. And it was a big blow up, you know, and because they were like some heavyweight author, you know, psychotherapy, whatever, that could tell people the truth and everything. I said, what you're saying here is just, it's just not true at all. You got it all wrong. And they're just furious with me. So this is what I faced, is that I said, no, you got it wrong. This is not, you're not right. And they just felt, they called me an egomaniac. You know, well, isn't the egomaniac one who claims that eternal life isn't eternal life? That's the egomaniac who thinks that they can change what God created. That's the egomaniac. All I'm saying is, no, we can't change what we are. God created us as eternal life, and we can't change it. That's the opposite of an egomaniac. So really, all these egomaniacs in the world were very uncivil to me and not very gracious at all, to put it mildly. And they said, you better get depressed, boy. You know, you got to get over this egomaniacalness that you have. That elation you have, that's just, you're an egomaniac. What are you talking about? So they finally beat me down. So yeah, I just deserve, I got to be depressed. How dare I think that I know more than Carl Gustav Jung, you know. Or Sri Aurobindo, you know, how dare I think, you know, he's all into transubstantiation and stuff, and nice poet, and freedom fighter, and yoga speculator, and practicer, and great guy, you know, but, you know, this is much clearer, it's way better, you know. Aurobindo was not Rama Maharshi, okay, he was not, and neither was the mother of Pondicherry, up there either. But, you know, I mean, appreciate their efforts. I mean, they were seekers, they were getting somewhere, and no. And so this is what I said. These people did not impress me. I said, no, they got it wrong. And people just freaked out. As persona non grata. Could you imagine, you know, attending, you know, these parties and intellectual parties and stuff where people are all discussing, you know, all the heavyweights of the world and what do you think about, you know, this, you know, yeah. And I'd say, you guys, all these, you're talking about all these people, they got it all wrong. I mean, this is ridiculous. Don't waste your time on this. Who the heck are you? You know. They might patronize you for a little while, like, let me set this guy straight, you know. But then they found out they couldn't. Then they'd start getting real, you know, upset because their own egomaniacalness would come to the surface. Their own arrogance came to the surface. And then they projected it onto me. You know, because they have no clue how to manage their success. This is the whole problem with society, okay? They are clueless as to how to manage their success. Now, if Ron Maharshi was here, would I sit with him? Well, I'd try. And my focus would be, well, I know this is a big, going to be a big challenge to manage my success, is all. And you just think about it and say, wow, okay. I know I'm going to really have to be focused in on managing my success and not go into depression, you know, just full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. And, you know, I'd give it a try. Well, you know, it's worth a try, right? It's worth a try. So society is going to get very depraved coming up in September. There's no question about it. And the road to hell is all greased, well paved and greased. And we don't want to go down that road. So the obstacles, we, you know, we're removing the obstacles and you know, I'm just speaking plainly now. Finally, I'm able to speak plainly. And just, you know, lay it on the line without getting depressed. You know, I've got to be careful, of course, because I have to manage my wow, too. You know, just doing this, you know, is a big wow factor, because most people think this will never be done. They'll never hear anything like this here. Problem with all the complexity, like Rohan Maharshi's pointed out, he said there's so many different teachings, so many different complexities, so many different words, so many. He says that's not necessary. What a pity, what a pity, what a pity. It's really very simple. And it is. Just do this practice of imitating abstraction. If you can't do that, then do positive assertions that you can. You can say, yes, I already know that I'm already canceling out concept. Yes, I already know that I'm already able to imitate abstraction. Yes, I know. I already know that imitating abstraction is the Holy Grail. You can do positive assertions about it. That's the third phase in spiritual practice, is positive assertions. And if you can't do positive assertions, then you can pray. Say, God, please give me the strength to do this imitation of abstraction practice. God, please give me the strength to do, you know, Holy Spirit, I pray, I ask you for the strength and spiritual wisdom to do this imitation of abstraction mental practice. You know, you can practice that, or if you can't do that, you can do the first phase and say, and just feel, I just really want to get to eternal life, and I really want to know how to do this. I really want to get to it, and I really want to do it, and you're expressing longing. That's the first phase. Second phase is you're actually praying to God, Holy Spirit, or whatever you pray, you know, the divine, please give me the courage and the wisdom to do the practice. Okay, that's the second phase. The third phase is you're asserting that you can do it. Yes, I already know that I'm already very adept at this practice. Yes, I already know this practice is very easy for me. Yes, I already know that I'm able to do the imitation of abstraction practice. Yes, I already know, you know, you're asserting you can do it, but you're not actually doing it. You see, and then the final fourth phase is where you actually do it. So everybody can do it. It's that simple. And there's a tendency, as Rohan Maharshi pointed out, that in spiritual nutritions of this world, it's become way too complex, way too complex, way too complex. Like Sri Aurobindo, you know, massive book. The book is just, and you know, like, these huge compound words, and it just intimidates you. It intimidates the heck out of you. But I just brushed it aside. I said, I kind of looked at it and said, well, he doesn't, you know, it's a lot of words, you know, a lot of sound and fury, but you know, it's still not spot on. You know, it's not spot on. What we're looking for here is what's spot on. And this is nice. I mean, he's making an effort, and you know, he's doing a lot of contemplation, meditation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But it's not spot on. We want streamlined, simple, get to the Holy Grail and wake up to eternal life. It's that and simple. And you know, he's trying to mix the super conscious, bring the light down into mortality and infuse moral existence with this and make a super consciousness and blah, blah, blah. No, that's all dualistic nonsense. This is all a dream. It doesn't exist. Moral existence has never existed, actually. The body has never existed. The flesh has never existed. It's all a figment of spiritual imagination. We don't need to do anything. It's not an obstacle at all. There is no obstacle to what we are. Just abide in the self, as Ramana said. There's the realization. Abiding in the self is the realization. That's all it is. That is the realization. So, it's, you know, it's very simple. We don't need to write a book about it. I just gave a synopsis right here. If you can't do this, I'm canceling out of abstractions, which some of you can do. I believe some of you can do this. Not many, but some. If you can't do that, do the assertions. If you can't do the assertions, do the prayers, but petitioning, you know. And if you can't do the petitioning prayer, then do the longing and keep articulating your longing. That's it. And if you don't want to do that, then you're just going to be lazy. That's all. You know, a little lazy life. To know, just wander around aimlessly is all you're going to do. Maybe you'll listen to the Bee Gees and take solace in that. So this is an alternative to what the world has to offer. And what the world has to offer, you're not going to like it. You're not going to like it. And you end up hating it, actually. So don't think the special relationship is going to give you what you want. Jesus seems to be obsessed with this, how bad the special relationship is. But he's not. He's obsessed. He's just emphasizing it. Because this is our chosen means to be lazy and to do what doesn't work. And thinking that the special relationship is going to give you solace from the intensities and jaggedness that is to come is ridiculous. It won't. But recognizing you have a path to awaken to eternal life, that will give you a center, you see. And so we're just streamlining it for you right now. If you can't do the practice of imitating abstraction, yes, I already know that I am both absolutely here and absolutely not here. Yes, I already know that I'm both absolutely everywhere and absolutely not everywhere, and on and on and on and on. If you can't do this, I am both this and not this. I am both that and not that. I am both free and not free. I am both true and not true. I am both a concept and not a concept. And I am neither I'm neither a concept nor am I not a concept, or the concept of no concept. Neither do I have a concept nor do I have a concept of no concept. You know, anyway, the practice is a wonderful practice. It's actually very easy when, you know, as you do it, you become better at it. And you use more and more like that stuff that really hits hard. I can't remember this morning everything I did, but that's okay because I'm focusing here on these four steps. If you can't do that, if you think the continuity fear is too severe, you go to try assertions. And we're very good at assertions here. And then if you can't do assertions, that's still too much continuity fear, go to prayer. And what most religions, you know, deal with prayer, right? The second stage. And if you can't do that, then go to the first stage of longing, like and thinking about it and articulating, like, yeah, I really, you know, it's just, I really want there's some way, you know, to return to life. I really feel like this mortal life isn't, you know, not what I really want. And I really wish I could find, you know, I'm attracted to the idea of some spiritual, you know, existence, of some eternal life, you know. You know, what do I need to do for that? And, you know, and just, it's on your mind. Eternal life is on your mind. That's the first step. And that you can do that. You see, everybody can do that. And then they realize, okay, there's four steps to it. And I can progress. And I don't have to do it all. Well, it's not a leap. You don't leap. You don't leap. You don't leap. You go through the four phases is what you do. You can't really leap. Your continuity fear won't allow it. You might leap and the elation will be so extreme, you go running back into depression. You hide in the depression. So if you try to force things, you're going to end up in depression because you can't handle the elation. You don't know how to handle your success. So we don't recommend forcing it. We recommend go through the different phases, but practice, practice, practice. Don't be lazy about it. Don't be lazy about it. Spiderweb there wasn't there a couple days ago, wasn't there at all. September. September, September, September. Real September to remember. I wouldn't be surprised if a couple stones hit the planet. Absolutely. They keep saying, however, you know, everyone legalized getting stoned. Well, they may get more stones than they counted on. They may get some literal stones here, you know, hitting the planet. Some people say this is the first volley of Planet X, you know. Some say that. And who's to say? But we may get those. This is indicated. It's been indicated to me. But, you know, hopefully nothing happens. And if it happens, you know, people are going to go running for shelter, you know. And, they'll, you know, if the special relationship is their cup of tea, they're going to go running right into that. If prayer is a thing, they'll go running to church and start pray. Okay, if assertions are it, they'll go assert. You know, if longing for eternal life is a little long and talk long, though you want to talk. And if the drinking from the Holy Grail of right spiritual practice, which is to practice the imitation of abstraction, is it? We're going to be doing that. But everyone is going to need a focus coming forward. This is what the Holy Spirit's trying to prod me, saying, hey, you know, you got to get ready for this. Because everybody's going to want to have a focus. They're going to need to focus in. And where's my center? What do I grab a hold of? What do I grab a hold of? I mean, the stock market is one thing, but if you compound it with other stuff, people are going to want. I have a friend that is like distraught right now because of the stock market. Got a lot of they're player in the stock market, and they're saying, "Oh my gosh, this is scary, very scary." And a lot of prophets of doom are coming out of the woodwork right now, saying crash is coming, for sure. I'm not saying crash is coming. I'm saying that the world in general is going to go into a very volatile period, a very agitated period, a very sharp agitation. You see, the sharpness of our agitation is the problem. It's much sharper now than it used to be. For instance, back in the 60s, there was a very agitated time. So many, many, many different movements are going on at the same time, all mixing free speech, civil rights, radical feminism, anti-war, anti-corporation, and just on and on, black power movement. What is that? All these things are dropping on the roof. It must be a squirrel eating a walnut. Yeah. Wow. That's interesting. That simulates like a whole bunch of rocks pelting down. Wow. Yeah, the Holy Spirit keeps emphasizing this rock thing, I'm telling you. In many, 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 many ways, it's emphasizing this, So what can I say? I mean, if it happens, it happens. But the sharpness of this, so back in the 60s, this volatile time, I mean, just marches everywhere, peace, you name it. I mean, it was so, but, there was civility there. It was amazing. It was amazing. We did not really alienate one another, and it was all okay. We all understood, and we were still, there's still love and peace and harmony and civility and everything, and it was so different than right now. The tone is so jagged now. So incredibly lawyerish, jaggedly, vicious sniping kind of thing. Well, sorry, let's take the lawyers thing out of it. It's gone beyond lawyerishness. The lawyers still try to have some sort of civility, as outrageous as some of the claims, that they'll say for their clients. But now it's sharp, sharp air. It's sharp. We have like everybody's carrying spears. They're prodding each other with knives and spears. It's viciously sharp. It's not going to be like the 60s, folks. Someone thinks there's going to be some big peace movement like the 60s. That is a pipe dream. That's an absolute pipe dream. No chance of that. The stuff that's coming to light is the apocalypse. I mean, what's coming to light is so nasty and people are so disgusted with it. If they're going to try and confront, it's going to become very volatile. And of course, if the stock market does crash, there's going to be blame flying around, severe blame. People will be furious, agitated, angry, and then desperate to calm their minds down. So where are they going to go to calm the minds down? To what they're used to, of course. Familiarity shapes our future. Familiarity is the major factor in shaping our future. Is doing what we're familiar with. Now, don't make the mistake of thinking that technology and this, the millennials and all this, are somehow, you know, breaking free of familiarity and pioneering something new. So that's nonsense. They're doing what they're familiar with. They're, most of them are from have come from a different planet, different planetary systems, star systems, where technology is what they're totally familiar with. That's all they know. So technology, 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 PC-ness, PC, 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 hive mind-ness, you know. And so they're just doing what they're used to doing. They're just going along with what they're familiar with. They reincarnate here, and they carry all those, you know, memory, and the mind is still, you know, is aware of all that stuff. And then they just go to keep right on doing what they're familiar with. So they're not pioneers in any stretch of the imagination. They're not having broken free of the, you know, of familiarity at all. So people will lapse, you know, we'll cling to what they're familiar with. So if we're familiar with the spiritual path, that's what we'll grab a hold of. And that's the only real safe thing to grab a hold of. When you grab a hold of that, you realize, hey, you know, this ultimately is the answer. So I'm not so freaked out, you know, whatever happens, you know, I know I'm on track. Now again, I don't know exactly what the Holy Spirit has in store for me. I've never really known exactly how it will work out. I just don't try to speculate. But certainly, we're going to need emphasis, you know, emphasis on, you know, stay on track. Where am I at on the spiritual path? Where am I at with my wow? Where am I with my wow? Okay, with my elation, where am I at? Phase 1, 2, 3, or 4. And where am I at with my elation? How am I managing my success? Where am I at with that? Those are just the simple questions. Those are the only questions we need to ask ourselves. That's it. Very easy. Very easy. And sometimes, you know, like even a fourth phaser can feel like a first phaser, you know. If they really are, you know, have struggling, they might talk as far as first phase, you know, stuff. But then if they remind themselves, oh, I'm just in severe wow, and oh yeah, okay, let me manage my elation consciously here. Then they come out of that just like that. So we don't need all these big books. We don't need all this massive complexity at all. Just where am I at? What phase am I focused on right now? And how am I with my wow? Just take a look at it. Just that simple. And we need simplicity now. We need simplicity. This is my goal, to simplify spiritual teaching. I say it's way too complex. And there's no way, with the agitation that's coming in the world, there's no way people are going to be able to succeed with this kind of complexity. It's ridiculous. They're going to want to very quickly assess their situation quickly and accurately. So those who are asserting, assert, right? Those who are longing, you know, articulate your longing and focus on it. Those who are praying, pray. Those who are asserting, assert. Those who are imitating abstraction, imitate abstraction. Let all four of those phases cherish one another, and realize this is all part of a, you know, we're on the same train tracks. It just, some are farther along down the track than others. It's like a young child look at their elder siblings and saying, "Yeah, one day I'm going to be like them," but don't begrudge them that they're, you know, farther down the tracks than you. You know, you'll get there too. How are we doing here on the video? Okay. Looks like we're about an hour and a half long, a little more than that. And the gigabyte usage, what are we doing on that? That's about normal. Okay, yeah. For some reason, I had that one video. It was like 3 hours and you know, 18 minutes or something. Just an anomaly. But I had to say, it's such important what was being said, that it turned out to be great that we had that time. But this one is more the standard 2 hour and 27 minutes sort of thing. It, for some reason, it's cutting off at 2:27 now. Before it was 2:31. It's got a mind of its own. So the first phase is often a lot of reading of books, you know, thinking, I feel there's something in, I'm really interested in, you know, spiritually. I just, you know, what is it, that kind of thing. And longing, first phase, really longing. And the second phase, you tend to be more religious in terms of praying. I really want to get eternal life somehow. How do I get it? Third phase is more focused, and you get into assertions. And I very directly say, I know I already am eternal life. I already know that I already am eternal life right now. Yes, I already know that I've already realized that I'm already eternal life right now. And each of these phases feels wonderful when you're doing these phases. You feel like this is really very, very potent and wonderful spiritual practice. And it is. This is it on the water. It's getting low. We're getting low in California. Ultra, ultra, ultra low. But that may all not matter that much. September, you know, it's going to be a September, remember, as far as agitation-wise. So I really want to be full blast in September, and I just, you know, ask my fellow elephants to come to my rescue, you know. Come to our aid, elephants. Great elephants of, you know, come to our aid at this time. We need to focus. We need to realize it. There can be a focus. And it's all about practicing, okay? It's all about practicing. We're gonna need it here in September. There could be a constellation of troubles in September. And a sliding into taking refuge. September, I believe, is when we'll try to take refuge from the storm. I believe the storm is going to hit in late August, which we're almost there, late August, and then going into September, this time frame. And we're going to take refuge. People will be seeking refuge. So we have this refuge here, this wonderful new table of, you know, black and white granite, very, very impervious and strong. Our friend the elephants will be there. Isn't that just a comforting thought? Imagine if you could go to a place and you knew that there were these big, really huge, amazingly compassionate and kind and wise elephants there. I mean, wouldn't you want to go? I sure would. you see the elephant, and you just, the elephant would, you know, raise its trunk or bow its head to you like this, and or flap its ears or something, and just acknowledge you, you know, like, yeah, I'm looking out after you, don't worry, you'll be safe here, you know. I mean, who's going to try to mess with the elephants, right? And so what a great refuge that is. Oh, yeah, I would certainly go to that. Go there. So we need these elephants to show up in some way and say, hey, we're here, we're here, we're here, we're here. Time to take refuge. It is the time to take refuge now. And everyone will take refuge. Everyone will be taking refuge soon. Very soon they will be taking refuge, or trying to. Which will be fun, which will be great, you know? I mean, it's time to take refuge from the world. So in taking refuge, just say, which of the four phases am I taking refuge in right now, and where am I at with the wow? Okay. Am I depressed? Oh, okay. Then it means I'm trying to, you know, it means I have a problem with elation, and I'm overcompensating, and instead I need to consciously focus on elation, and stand with it, say, okay, I'm going to stand here with that until it, and consciously allow it to dissipate. I had this dream where a gloomy disappointment left me. I said, where are you going? You don't have to leave. No, they left. Gloomy disappointment left me. That means I have no more gloomy disappointment. I'm not able to you know, feel that way. That'll be great. The world cannot tell me how I feel at all. The world has nothing to do with how we feel. It does absolutely nothing to cause us to feel anything at all, actually. This is one of Jesus' central points, also so important. We're absolute sovereigns over our own experiencing, and there's no causative effect outside of ourselves at all. None. We're only pretending that there is. And so the world has nothing to say about how I feel. Never will. Never will. I feel the way God created me to feel, which is happy, which is blissful. Free, and love, free, bliss, you know, gratitude, compassion. This is how I feel. This is natural feeling for everyone, and we can't change that. And so the world cannot dictate to us how we feel. Doesn't matter what happens here. It has no bearing on how we feel whatsoever. And this will become as a realization to us more and more and more. And this may be the gloomy disappointment, you know, left me. It's, can't feel that way anymore. Cannot feel that way anymore. Which would certainly be a great asset in the world right now. the events that happen, everything that happens, that's not causing us to feel anything. We're just imagining how we feel. And we're just pretending to feel all this way. Just drop the pretense and we'll feel perfect. The world does nothing to us. This is just a mental projection. It doesn't do anything to us. It cannot cause us to feel anything whatsoever. Sometimes I'm getting these, you know, quick releases of struggle that just suddenly, you know, a feeling like a reaction of struggle will just ripple through me and gone like that. And I had some buzzing at the base of my skull yesterday after I was resting, taking a nap. Suddenly the base of my skull, there was just this intense buzzing. Like, it is amazing, so rapid. And then it just ceased. And then it came back and did again. Very strong. Vibrational buzzing. I was quite shocked by that. I said, what in the world is that? But sometimes also just this sort of a shake, a quick shake of this. You know, you're releasing the whole mentality of struggle. So, you know, the idea of being impervious to depression is super important in this world right now. Those are the ones, the elephants you want. Those who are impervious to depression simply cannot get depressed, impossible. Those are the ones you want. Those are the ones that can help us stay on track. And not because they need to do anything. They're just inherently impervious. It's not like a difficult struggle for them. They have to take pills or do this or this or that. No. It is very, very interesting, folks, that the female Viagra pill has just been approved by the FDA. This is no coincidence. You know, from what I've been told by the Holy Spirit and shown, and I know, you know, I've said in other videos, what's going to happen is girls gone wild is what's going to happen. And the guys already know, the young guys I talked to, they said, the women our age, you know, they're just absolutely out of control. They call them disgusting, actually. They, you know, don't like it at all. And now they got this female pill, you know, which could, you know, strong placebo. They believe in it. It's going to have, you know, placebo effect, as all pills do. Really, they're all placebos. But, belief is very strong within belief systems. Belief seems to have a lot of strength. It just now it's been okayed by the FDA. Isn't that amazing? The young men are already disgusted by the young women in the world. They're already disgusted. There's no question about it. You know, they call them, you know, names, vile, disgusting, revolting, gross. You know, I mean, stuff like that. They're just gross. They're just very gross. Oh, yeah, they're grossly materialistic. Horrors of Babylon are here. And they, you know, they feel insatiable. Desire is their ticket to enormous power and control. And they feel that there's going to be just a massive amount of men and women actually desperate for some sort of special relationship that just doesn't fizzle out, you know. And so they're looking for, you know, wild times, just, you know, a wild fling that just goes and goes and goes. And there are those who are going to exploit that, and they'll just get everything possible from them, their money, their property, their everything, you know. And this is, they see this a great opportunity for, you know, super criminality, so to speak. And that's what's coming. The agitation that's coming in people's, in our minds, without being able to truly center on a spiritual path leads to desperate refugee taking refuge. And these whores of Babylon will say, hey, sailor, take refuge here. You know, and they'll say it both to both men and women. Keep this in mind, that these whores of Babylon, bisexual, and they will go after the money any way they can get it. They'll go after whatever they can get. Absolutely. No shame, just full-on exploitation. Take refuge here is what they'll be saying. You know, men and women, the whores of Babylon, both men and women. And there's some, you know, some men have trained that way too. Absolutely. And again, bisexual, this is why this whole generation is so extremely bisexual, is they're preparing for this opportunity that they see is taking, they say, hey, take refuge here, you know, take refuge here, I'm the answer to your agitation, take refuge there. And this is, you know, being, these are the sirens that lure you to, you know, destruction upon the rocks. This is the siren song. And of course, youth provides the energy to pursue this sort of thing, along with all the drugs that they're going to use, have available. And of course, they'll be, you know, they carry, you know, all this Viagra for the men, whatever. Take this. Just keep them hooked on that, you know. Just keep them hooked on that. In the past, it was cocaine, you know, that they used. But they have now a lot more, a fuller palate, a fuller pharmaceutical palate from which to peruse. And apply. So this, you know, this is coming now. A lot of maybe guys and gals thinking, oh, wow, this is great, really a party, wow, just free for all, huh? You know, free for all, decadence, oh, wow. But I think most people of any wisdom say, you know, this is gross. This is absolutely gross. And I don't want that. So it may be surprising. Maybe more people will go to the spiritual path than what we expect right now. Is after they get grossed out by this, they're saying, wow. And real repentance isn't a Mary Magdalene saying, oh yeah, I'm a repentant prostitute, you know, and that, you know, it's practicing. It's not saying, oh, I love you so much. They're just looking at another opportunity. You're saying, maybe this is a better opportunity for wealth and getting stuff. It's practicing. The real repentance is doing one of the four phases of practicing. This is how you know them. And they're sincere about their practicing. They believe in it, and they're sincere about it. They're not just mouthing the prayers, mouthing the words, trying to convince you that they're, you know, really into it. No, it's that they actually believe in it. They're sincere about it, and they're doing their utmost. You know, when they pray to God, they're really praying, God, I really want your help, and I really will accept your help right now. This, you know, so help me, please. They're absolutely sincere. I'm sincere when I pray, absolutely. When I'm thinking, first phase sincere, second phase, when I'm making assertions, absolutely I'm sincere. Yes, I already know that I'm already awake to eternal life. I'm absolutely know that I already am eternal life. I am eternal life right now. Okay. And then the canceling out. Imitating abstraction process. Yes, I already know that I am both absolutely eternal life and absolutely not eternal life. I am both absolutely eternal life and absolutely not eternal life. I am both absolutely happy and absolutely not happy. I am both absolutely thinking and absolutely not thinking. I am both absolutely conceptualizing and absolutely not conceptualizing. And so, I feel sincerity in all four of those phases, you see, absolutely. And this is what, you know, is the true repentant, the one who's truly repentant, is practicing. They're not trying to put the make on somebody. They're practicing. We don't know. They've done all this, you know, spin on Mary Magdalene. We don't really know what the story actually was, you know. She could just, she said, hey, maybe I can hook Jesus, you know. Maybe that was her thing. You know, we don't know what all the stories, how it was spun, the Gospels were spun, etc., etc. So, the key is, you have to actually get on the spiritual path and truly repent and realize, you know, this is not for me. Eternal life is for me. And I got to get serious about it. And, you know, leave the past behind. Just say, I'm done with it. And, you know, the idea of, you know, oh, maybe I could have made, you know, $1 billion if I just hooked the right fish and got them to turn everything over to me in their desperation and their panic, which many will do. It's happening right now in assisted living situations, just right and left, as well as in just ordinary life. You know, you get desperate people who are agitated with a lot of money, and, you know, you're going to find somebody's going to come and find a way to get you to give them all that money and give you everything. They're experts at it. That's, you know, just like a boar beetle, isn't it? What do? They bore into a tree. That's what they do. They're experts at it. That's how they're geared, mentally geared that way. They gear themselves that way. And the clever ones send out surrogates, you know, to try to soften up the target. They're very clever. They'll send out surrogates to soften up the target, absolutely. To get them distressed. Just get them so distressed, then they come in at some point, you know. And when you try to pull you down into depression. So we're here, you know, emphasizing how to get out of depression. Because depression makes you vulnerable. Makes you very vulnerable, especially when you're making the effort to get out, but you still don't really know how to. Then you think, maybe I can make it, and then you get hooked. You know, you get hooked. So we're here explicitly telling everyone, the full stop and while. We walk together in the wow here. This is what we do. We walk together in the wow. That's what we're doing. And we're emphasizing how to manage your success properly, the elation properly, so you don't become vulnerable to the horrors of Babylon. Because, you know, when you're depressed, you're going to try to get out of depression one way or the other, right? And if you haven't learned the expertise in how to manage your success, you are going to be very vulnerable to being hooked. And same with agitation. I mean, a lot of people will take refuge in depression because at least depression, you know, seems to calm down the agitation. I'm just defeated, you know, I'm in a fetal position. That's preferable to the mind just out of control. There's nothing scarier than a mind just out of control. So I can't stop it. You know, it's horrible. And the term horrible is rather apropos because it leaves you vulnerable to horrors is what it does. And I'm talking about both men and women here. Okay. There's a lot of gigolos that prey on elder women, that is for sure. Absolutely, for sure, that's true. And look out for them, too. There's a lot of guys who have also prepared for this situation. And, you know, the advice will be flying through the consciousness of the planet. Hey, you know, you feel agitated, you're really disturbed, you know, have an affair, you know, you know, live your life. Your life's about over anyway, you know. Might as well live it, you know, for the full right now. You know, let's party kind of thing. This is what's going to, a mania is going to grip the world. A mania is going to grip the world. It's coming. And so we have to be impervious. Someone has to be impervious to it. The elephants need to be impervious. You know, the elephants are solid. They're grounded. Nothing can move them, right? You try to push an elephant over. Is the elephant a pushover? If the elephant doesn't want to move, you can't move it. They'll move the bulldozer. You try to throw a bulldozer at them, they'll end up moving the bulldozer. They'll push the bulldozer over. So we need these elephants that are impervious. And then we can take refuge in that and say, hey, I'm going to take this elephant refuge situation for sure. And we'll leave the partying for others who are, you know, foolish. You know, there was that parable, the foolish, 10 the foolish virgins. Five, you know, went out partying, and five, you know, the others, you know, got oil for their lamps and were, you know, chaste and did not go that direction. And when the, you know, the time came to take refuge, they took refuge. And the others said, oh, you know, we have to go to the market to get oil for our lamps. We were too busy partying to do that. And by the time they came back, the door was closed. This is what Jesus is talking about. It's not a joke what he's saying. Of course, oil in the lamp means familiarity with spiritual practice. That's what oil in the lamp is. Because in the agitation, you can light the lamp and take refuge in it. Light the lamp of familiarity and take refuge in that. If you haven't built up familiarity, you're going to go to what you're familiar with automatically. You're not going to change horses in the middle of a hurricane. You know, I mean, you're going to ride on what you're riding. And so it's fortunate are the ones that are prepared ahead of time. It's quite warm here. Quite warm. Getting hammered by the sun. So this is all coming up very soon. The signs are just getting, you know, right and left for me now. It's like, wow. So we need to be the elephant. Be the elephant. Got to be an elephant. Hey, what goes on in the mind of an elephant? I don't know. It's pretty interesting. They've got a big head. I mean, you know, just motor control and the basic functioning of a creature. I mean, you can put those in an insect, you know. I mean, you don't need a big brain to just do basic stuff, you know. All animals, all life forms here, you know, they do the basic stuff. And how tiny that. So what is the elephant's brain is so gigantic? You know, what is that for? I don't know. Or maybe it's not gigantic. I don't know. Maybe the size is not so huge. I think they said that the dinosaurs had like pea size. You know, the size of their brain was like size of a pea or something. So maybe elephants are not gigantic. Of course, they can be trained to do a massive array of things. Pretty amazing how elephants could be in parades like the way they are, with all these people milling about them, you know, and they can keep their wits about them like this and function like, wow. You see the in Puri, the Jagannath procession. You know, I think the elephant. I know the people are pulling the chariot, but I've seen elephants there too. Occasionally they get out of control. If certain things happen, they get spooked or something, but usually they're able to handle all the pressure and the milling and the fervor and everything. You know, they're untouched by it. They're up above it. They're up above it all. Wow, these squirrels are just eating walnuts like crazy here, dropping it down on the roof. Dunk, 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 like rocks hitting the roof. Maybe a whole lot of rocks are coming in. Possible. If Planet X is headed our way, and of course we've heard that for a long time. We'll soon see. There's some perturber for sure out there. We know that. But the bottom line remains the same, is where are you going to take refuge? Everyone will take refuge somewhere, or try to. Some will just curl up in a fetal position. But, you know, we may crouch beneath a, you know, table that protects us, which is the protection of true spiritual teaching. As Jesus said, the words, my words, are full of spirit and life. You know, this is the flesh profiteth nothing. You know, the flesh, he's talking about his flesh too. Flesh proud of nothing. Of course, he knows there's no such thing as flesh. If there's no such thing as flesh, how can you eat it and drink it? You know, drink the blood of it. It's not real. It's an illusion. It's a mirage. It's a pretense. It's an impersonation. September, October, November, December. So we have 4 months to go in this year. And then January, February, March, April, May, June. 5 months in the June. So like about 9 months to go here. But now we're seeing, working so hard, we're seeing now that, hey, We can't take refuge. There will be a refuge. We understand the refuge now. Wow. It's all been streamlined. It's all been very streamlined. I don't have to suddenly grab a, you know, 2,000 page book and try to wolf it down, you know, today to avoid, you know, to calm my agitated mind down. I can say, hey, it's taking refuge. Okay, where do I take refuge? Okay, what stage am I at on the path? Oh, okay, let's do that stage then. And let's do it with an awareness that there are these other stages, and that when I do this stage properly and then manage my success, which is all important, those other stages are there for me also. So I won't just fall off the wagon. You know, I'll stay on it. I'll stay on it. And then, you know, you calm down. You say, I'm good. I'm good. I'm good here. Okay, what's the key again? Managing your success. Managing your success. Managing your success. The wow, the wow, the wow, the elation. The mixture of elation and trepidation. Highlight the elation and stick with it. Stick with it. Don't go negative. Of course, you'll try different ways to tone it down, but try not to do anything to tone it down, really. Some people will try to play guitar, you know, try to tone it down that way. I don't recommend that at all. I used to do that. I've done that a lot. It didn't work. Didn't work. Made things worse, actually. I got more nervous and jittery. So I do not recommend, nor do I recommend singing. Okay, I tried that. I've tried just about everything. Doesn't work. Makes it worse. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Being quiet and sitting still and being with the wow, like as if you're hearing a bell reverberating, and just stay with the reverberation. That's what works. Full stop in the wow is what works. This full stop term is a term of, you know, used by non-dualists. It's a good term. I think it part of the origination was from Sailor Bob Adamson, I believe. Some of those who are students of him and students of students, etc. It got kind of passed around in the lexicon. We're saying full stop in the wow, which is so important. It's a very important tool to have. I first heard this from a teacher. I went to see him. He was advertising that he's holding this spiritual gathering, and I just happened to be down in Southern California at the time. So I said, wow. I found it online, or somehow I found about it, but I thought this is going to be a big deal. So I said, this is a priority. I got to go to this. I'm going to try. I'm going to make an effort. So I got there, and I said, well, am I early? What's going on? You know, there's nobody else there. And I said, okay, wait for you guys to show up. Where's the crowd? Where's the big group? Well, it turns out I was the only one there. And so, I was so put off guard by that. You know, it was a very awkward situation. But the one there who used this term full stop, I remember using that full stop. I said, what is he talking about, full stop? You know, what is this? But I wasn't really focused in on it, because I said, wow, is this okay? I mean, my impression, what happened was so different than my impression. You don't think you're going to some heavyweight spiritual teacher and you say this is like they're once a year or something, this is a big thing, and you're the only person there. You say, wait a minute, you know, this is, you know. It's like someone advertising a big party. Hey, gals, you know, girl, guys or gals, whatever, you know, come to this big party. So you show up at the party, and then, you know, and then you're the only one there, and you say, uh-oh. I mean, if you're a woman, you know, let's say, wait a minute. Is this some sort of entrapment, you know? I mean, you start thinking, right? So I was thinking. However, I did get something out of that, where the term full stop, I said, what does that mean? You know, what does that mean? And then years later now, you know, I come up with the term full stop in the wow. And I say, yeah. You know, it wasn't explained to me the way I explain it, but it's still a potent, you know, it's a potent term. I'm pretty sure Sailor Bob Adamson used that, and those who studied with him used it. Like a John Wheeler and various other teachers that, you know, there's a full stop, just full stop right now. Just full stop in the now. Full stop in the now. Just this. You know, this is part of the shtick of non-duality type of thing. But we have a much clearer presentation of that, much, much clearer, okay? I have to say that, that this is way clearer than what we're used to seeing in non-duality teaching. Because we're very explicitly pointing out, it's entirely to manage your success, with the elation, the wow. It's full stop in the wow. From your practicing, that you get the sudden, you know, glimpses of your freedom and realization, I can do this. When you recognize I can do this, you're just going to be scintillating with elation. And it's then you need to full stop in the wow. But you know, with teachers, they do have good intentions. I think most of them do. And So when they hear that something that they expressed is you know, somehow been incorporated and being expressed, you know, part of, they say, hey, that's great. It's like musician, you know, I did some riff here and somebody else was inspired by that riff and is putting out some beautiful music because of that. You know, hey, that's really satisfying. That's great. That's great. You know, ideas are to be shared. So share everything with everyone in terms of ideas. Don't share your body with everybody. Share your ideas, you know, with everybody. The thoughts you think with God, the ideas of God, you know, share those. So, you know, managing your success on the spiritual path is all important. Can't do it without it. And this is what we overlook. Even the non-dual teachers, I don't see any emphasis on that. They don't get it. You know, it's just, come on, can you awake? Come on, try to wake up. Oh, let's keep trying. You know, that's not the way. Know that you are for sure going to awaken. There's no question about it. You don't need to even question yourself at that. There's no, you just have to over evaporate the continuity problem. That's all. These limitations are just phantoms. But that's not the problem. The problem is you think that pretending is your function. So you cannot just immediately wake up. And if you, and some of these non-dual teachers can push you into momentary awakening, but then there's backlash on it. And you hear about this all the time. Is I was enlightened for a while, and I was in a state for like a couple of days or weeks or months, or you know, and then you know it went away, and you know I fell into a deep depression, you know, after that, and you know, never been able to get back to it and stuff like that. That's not the way. Okay, that's not the right path. You have to be way more sophisticated than that, and aware of the context. Like Shankara said, Adi Shankara said, you know, it's your career. Look at it as your lifetime career. Don't worry about forcing anything. Don't try to force anything. Just work at it every day as much as you can. And like Ramana Maharshi said, you know, it'll turn out all right in the end. Don't worry. Everything turns out all right in the end. Okay, when they asked him all sorts of questions, he said, look, it's going to turn out all right in the end. Guarantee you this. So calm down. You know, manage your success. Keep working diligently. We're not trying to trick anybody into enlightenment here. It's about evaporating your continuity fear. And ultimately, the fourth stage is to, you know, practice imitating pure abstraction, conceptually imitating it by canceling out concepts. I'm both absolutely elated and absolutely not elated. I am both absolutely in elation and absolutely not in elation. And this will put you, you know, full stop, you know, full stop right there. Like, wow. Wow. There's, you know, this abstraction. Like, wow. I'm, there's some ancient memory, you know, that's just, I can't put my finger on it because it's pure abstraction, but I'm sort of breathing, you know, like a scent comes by, like this, where did that scent come from? Maybe some of you are experiencing that. Of a sudden, there's a scent drifting by. Where'd that come from? I've had this happen now a number of times. It's been happening. Normally, it's just, you know, just a normal scent of, like for me, I'm outside, so just a normal scent of right here, dirt, plants, whatever. But sometimes there'll be this ethereal scent that'll just drift by, like a memory of something. You know, long, long ago, something that's so precious, something very precious, like a faint echo of something so precious, and you just say, wow, I'm experiencing this right now. I'm experiencing this. You see, don't disassociate from it intellectually, say, or emotionally. Say, I am experiencing this right now. Wow. Go into the elation, you know, go into the elation of it. Allow yourself to feel the elation of this. This is huge. You're getting used to riding the elephant, or being an elephant. Used to being an elephant. This is huge. So there's always something on the spiritual path to have a wow reaction to really say, wow, this is. You just have to keep looking for it. Keep looking for it. Keep finding it. Like, wow, I've really made a lot of progress. I'm really, I'm really hearing this. This is extraordinary. Wow. And we can just say, hey, this stress is way more interesting than the stress the world gives us. Really, you know, this, you really can't do that. See, I don't really need the stress of the world. I've got this extraordinary stress that I'm feeling, you know, and because, you know, most of us are, you know, thrill seekers, adrenaline seekers, we'd stress seekers, we want, you know, challenge seekers. And we say, hey, this is the highest challenge there is. This spiritual path is really the, it makes all the stress of the world and politics and protests just feel like child's play. I mean, it's really, it does. It's like, you know, building sandcastles. I mean, you know, it's just really not very attractive. Interesting. Castles made of sand melt into the sea. I was going to say, it's like, it's not interesting except if you're at the Wyndham Golf Tournament in North Carolina, that they do these extraordinary sand sculptures there. There's a tradition. Of course, sand castles melt into the sea. They're vulnerable. And I'm just wondering, you know, if that's a sign the Eastern Seaboard is vulnerable. This brick, I was carrying these three bricks and one of them fell on me. I couldn't understand it. Hit my thumbnail. Still has left the print. If you look at it like this, it looks just like the east coast of the United States. This black mark there. Like, there's just going to be a hit there, you know? This is what this pastor in, Dominican Republic has been saying. That he was shown this. Sort of shown the future, what's going to happen. Well, I don't know, but it's pretty doggone interesting that this has not gone away, this mark. And it was from this rogue brick that I don't understand how the heck it, you know, how it hit me so hard. It was horrible. I couldn't believe it. And all the various scrapes I've gone through, this little brick that just sort of toppled. I had three in my hand. It sort of somehow toppled somehow. It just hurt it worse than anything. It was crazy. I just like, and people are looking at me like, what happened? Brick hit my thumb, huh? Yeah, I was in severe pain. It went on and on and on. Very long time. I felt stupid, you know? Like, people think I'm some kind of wimp. It's like, and I felt like, come on, you know? Usually just shake it off, you know? It's just pain. But this was extraordinarily painful. So, you know, like a freakish thing. So, you know, it could be presaging, an asteroid hitting the ocean and causing extraordinary damage. It's possible. More than we calculate. You know, we think, oh, you know, asteroid hits the ocean, what's the big deal? Well, it depends what angle it hits it at, you know, what its velocity, what its mass is, the depth of the ocean. I mean, how close it is to the shore. I mean, there's a lot of factors. How much does it burn up in the atmosphere? You know, but this experience I had, it was like, I couldn't imagine how I got so much pain out of this situation. So, you know, it's interesting how there are these precursors we get, calling cards of the future. You know, we get these calling cards. Hopefully getting these calling cards can help us realize we really don't need this. We really don't need it. It's not necessarily a fait accompli, but we're about there. Oh, we're going to get some extra time, it looks like. In fact, we're already in extra time. How extraordinary. Wow, that's great. How did that happen? I cannot definitively say, but I can say there have been a lot of signs, I'll tell you this, over the years, a lot of signs. So it would certainly not come as no surprise. You just shrug and say, well, okay, Holy Spirit's right again. But I don't know exactly what the time frame we're talking about. And I don't want people to get, you know, jittery and nervous about it. Really, it's just something that to be aware is one of many possibilities as we're now in, you know, heading into what many would call is the end times, where the Bible says, you know, you get these vials of tribulation, the angels pour out these vials of tribulation one after the other. One of them is they're hurling rocks down at the earth. That's one of the vials of the tribulation. And this, we're told that this is the worst ever. Now, a lot of people say it's Planet X making its passage around this earth, and this is going to be the worst passage ever. I mean, there's historical evidence that this, that some complex is actually maybe a brown dwarf, a red dwarf, something like that, a star, that, you know, that it's not actually a planet, it's a star, which, and it has a lot of rocks orbiting it, etc., moons. And, you know, this became popular with Sitchin, the author Sitchin, and of course Emmanuel Velikovsky also posited some sort of situation, you know, similar. And of course the ancient Sumerians are supposed to know all about this, wrote about it and talked about its, you know, periodicity of when it comes every, you know, so many thousands of years, whatever. And some say it's due back now. It's due back. And that will bring a whole lot of turbulence. Some say an axis tilt, etc., etc., etc. But some say it's not going to be that severe, and maybe it won't show up. You know, there's different opinions on it. And I have ceased to go over and over and over that, because I've really spent a lot of my life focusing on global disaster, because the historical record is very clear. There have been many global disasters, not accountable by anything that we could say, except something coming from outer space that really does, you know, cause massive tidal waves and all sorts of, you know, along those lines. I mean, we have massive rocks on top of mountains that obviously came from the seashore. You know, massive deposits of shells and sand deposited high up in mountains, that tectonic uplifting activity cannot account for it. You know, the deposits are way too recent to say that, well, the mountain was one time down at the ocean level and now is being pushed up. Well, what could cause such rapid rise in mountain ranges, for one thing? I mean, look at the Himalayan mountains. I mean, this is what, all plate tectonics? And you know, really? There hasn't been anything else caused massive uplift in a rapid fashion? Seems to be a lot of evidence that, you know, the change of geological theory is punctuated with rapid change. So you find these deposits in places where they shouldn't be. There's no question about it. I mean, they find these deposits in caves, for instance, on island, various places and islands, which clearly shows the water, the ocean was up at that level, depositing sand and shells and everything in these caves, okay? At high elevations, a volcano has been extinct for a long time, so there's been no rising of the level of these caves at all, okay? And in order to deposit these deposits, the tsunami must have been massive, absolutely massive. What could cause such massive tsunamis? We've already had a 9.0 earthquake in Japan, you know, and it produced this, you know, what was it, the actual wave across the ocean was not so big at all, just a foot and a half or 2 feet. And then when it started getting closer to land, it started getting higher, but it still wasn't some massive wall of water. You know, it pushed in, water of the ocean pushed in, and there was a few waves, so to speak, but it's not like, you know, the water level just started flowing over, flowing inland as the whole sea level, you know, rose. But we're talking about sea level rising, you know, super rapidly depositing this stuff. Huge elevation. Now, we know that a 9.0 doesn't produce that kind of elevation change. I mean, even a 10.0 wouldn't produce it. So, I mean, what kind of earthquakes could possibly produce that? You see, it would have to be some sort of, you know, mega quake or mega asteroids or axis tilt or some sort of huge gravitational event. You know, I mean, there's some, it'd have to be some sort of extraordinary forces at play to produce that kind of those kind of massive tsunamis. And we have historical records, ancient peoples have records of you know, walls of water just marching across the whole continent, their whole land. Huge walls of water. They have all sorts of records in their traditions all over the planet. So we know that stuff has happened here. There's no question about it. And is this, you know, associated with Planet X, and is Planet X back? These are other variables. Other variables. But, you know, don't rule it out. I mean, something's, the Holy Spirit's indicating something is about, you know, to be upon us, where we will feel a need to take refuge. Now, it could just be ideological, which is the worst kind of all, actually. Jesus said, don't fear those who can kill the body, fear those who can kill the spirit. Meaning, of course, you can't kill spirit, meaning that fear those that can make you feel dissociated from spirit, make you believe that you're not spirit. Make you, you know, who emphasize the belief that you're mortal existence, that you're the body. Fear those. Fear that way more than just those who were, you know, kill the flesh. Because that puts you into a whole mindset that gives rise to cycles and cycles and cycles of flesh identification. That's what's to be feared. So it's really ideological disasters that are the most dangerous. But natural catastrophes can put us into a state of inarticulateness and panic and agitation, where we then become vulnerable to listening to the ego and taking refuge where the ego tells us to take refuge, and that ends up being a very bad decision for us. So it doesn't help at all. It's a contributing factor to spiritual inarticulateness. Now, we've had stuff in the 21st century happen already. It seems to be the century of disasters. You know, one day we wake up, and there's been a huge, you know, tsunami. I think we've had two mega tsunamies. Let's just say strong, not the ones where, you know, we're positing that could really be extraordinary, but two strong ones, and you know, the oil blowout in the Gulf of Mexico. I think what Hurricane Katrina was an extraordinary disaster, and Sandy on the East Coast. I mean, and it goes on and on. So, it wouldn't be a surprise at all to wake up someday and we find out that something else has happened. But we would say, okay, well, I'm just going to continue on what I'm doing. I know this is the path to eternal life, plain and simple. And I can never agree or accept the belief system of mortal life. I can never accept it. So there's nothing else for me to do but to pursue this path of eternal life as vigorously as I can and dedicatedly as I can. There's nothing else for me to do. It's just to keep pursuing this. And this is the right path. This is the right thing. What's right to do? The next 4 months, there is a high likelihood. I mean, what today take? That would take us up to December, to take up to actually Christmas Day, wouldn't it? Whoa! Holy cow! Did you just hear that? Oh my gosh! Let me go grab what just happened. That scared the heck out of me. Just as I mentioned Christmas Day, there was this huge hit right above my head on the roof, like a big rock had been dropped. Let me go show you what happened here. Just one moment. Okay. Wow. It was this double walnut. It was connected like this somehow. Two of them are connected together. Okay. These two walnuts here. And this fell, boom, right, I don't know if you heard it, right above my head on this roof, and made a very loud noise. It scared the heck out of me. Now, these are fairly heavy. I mean, these are juicy, heavy walnuts. And it was a double walnut that hit. I mean, you know, then some teeth marks of the squirrel are on this walnut here. I don't know if you can see it, but, you know, the squirrel was going after it and knocked both of these off together, and it came down together, and wham! It's similar to the shape that some seers have said the asteroid will be. It'd be sort of elongated shape, sort of like that sort of thing, like a barbell, kind of elongated shape, more than a circular sort of thing. Holy cow. That got my heart pounding. That was a thunk, like I thought a substantial rock had just been dropped right on top where my head would be. But we have shelter here, right? So it didn't harm us in the slightest bit. But holy cow, that is alarming. That is alarming. I mean, this squirrel could be anywhere on this tree or take its nuts somewhere else. And it happened to drop it directly above my head right there. Direct hit. It just happened, the squirrel, right at the moment. This is saying Christmas 2:15. Wham! That's a shaker. That shakes me up. But of course, who will believe that? Very few believe it. Most people don't want to. They say, I don't want to think about it. Okay, fine. But in the back of your mind, you have to think or dwell on it. Just say, you know what, I really got to get into spiritual practice. I really got to get clued into this. I really got to understand how to take refuge. Very important. No matter what happens, I would say going forward in this world, you will need to take refuge. In some way, you'll be taking refuge. Everybody will. It's getting too jagged. It's getting too jagged for us. Just too much, you know, too much terrorism, too much jaggedism, too much incivility, too much polarization, too much aggression, too much jitters, you know, you name it. Somebody's got the jitters over something. At some point, you know, just the inner within them, they may seem to be just a normal person just going along. And at some point, some within will say, I can't take it anymore. I've got to take refuge in this or take refuge in that, you know. And this is why that crazy website of adultery website was so popular. It is obviously these are people that are just desperate to take refuge in something. They think that this is the answer, and they're being encouraged to do so. And it was wildly successful. It just shows you how depraved the society is, and you know, normal people won't do that. There must be within them just saying, hey, I can't take it anymore. I've got to find some refuge, you know, and here's somebody saying, this will work for you, you know. And so, you know, they've been conditioned to think, well, maybe this will work for me. And of course it doesn't, it just makes things worse. But this is the way the whores of Babylon work, male and female, is to say, hey, you know, take refuge in the flesh. Take refuge in the flesh. Here's, yeah, your mortal flesh, but don't worry, you can take refuge in this. Here, by contradistinction, we're saying you are not mortal flesh. You've never been mortal flesh. You're not mortal flesh now. You never will be. You are absolutely eternal life. Everyone is without exception. There's no exception to this whatsoever. We're absolutely adamant and clear-cut about this. It's black and white. There's no confusion. It's black and white. It's put in stark contrast. Okay? What is the... Okay, we're getting extra time, extra time, extra time. A little bit, just enough. So just keep processing this, and say, yeah, I want to take refuge in this very adamant black and white. There's no exception to this. We are eternal life. We've always been. This mortal life is but a dream. All this is but a dream. And we don't quite understand what I mean by a dream. Well, it's we're pretending. Spirit is pretending. It's doing an imitation. It's impersonating, trying to impersonate itself, as it were. There's different ways you can say it. But the creativity of spirit is unlimited. So when spirit wants to imagine that it's not itself, it will seem, the dream will seem absolutely, realist.